Astrology, the science of cosmic oneness and harmony. At the moment a child takes birth, many stars emerge from around the Earth's horizon, and each movement of the star emits a specific vibration. Also, each star has its own individual movement. All these vibrations together create a musical harmony. Pythagoras has called this as the harmony of the universe. This cosmic harmony regulates the state of health and illness throughout the life. When there is an imbalance, there is illness, and when the balance is restored, the health comes back. This is an investigation into various aspects of astrology. In the beginning, the fathomless zero occupied the cosmos and your world of finiteness. It is out of this fathomless zero first evolved the ether or the sky, then came air, followed by fire and remaining elements, the water, the earth, and thus life evolved, the soul, the mind, and the physical body. Your physical body is a mere showcase of all that happens at other planes or bodies. Then question comes, from where can healing really happen? Since physical body is a mere showcase, definitely it cannot be the beginning. Regular astrology begins from here, but not the meditation. Can we start at bioplasmic level, or you still have to go a step beyond? There are so many unresolved issues in each one of you that needs to be addressed before the work of astrology may begin. Through these meditations, I'm trying to create a balance between body and the mind. Only then you can attain to meditativeness. As far as astrology is concerned, it is the most ancient subject, and also in a way it has been ignored over the period of time. It is the most ancient because astrology has been in existence since the dawn of human civilization. Astrological inscriptions have been found on bone remnants from the Sumerian civilization, which is said to have existed nearly 25,000 years before Jesus. Bone remnants have been discovered with astrological inscriptions and with an outline of moon's orbit in the sky. But in India, the science is even older. One of the ancient scriptures, Rig Veda, has a mention of a particular constellation of stars, which now scientists have proved that it happened 95,000 years ago. When something is mentioned in the scripture that happened 95,000 years ago, that means the scripture existed even before that. That particular Vedic reference could not have been added at a later date. Other younger generations would not have been able to work out the constellation that existed many years before. But now we have scientific methods which can be used to discover whether the stars were at a particular moment in the distant past. The deepest law of astrology was first discovered in India, and in fact it is only because of astrology that mathematics came into existence. To make astrological calculations, mathematics is essential. Mathematical numbers and other equations. The digits used in our arithmetic were invented in India, the numbers from 1 to 10, and 0 was given by one of the scientists astro scientists are given. When we use the number, these numbers are used throughout the world. Decimal system was born in India and it has now spread the entire world. When we use the word 9 in English, it comes from the Sanskrit root, which means new as well as 9. Similar is the case of the other numbers 1 to 9. The first knowledge about the existence of astrology reached Sumerian civilizations from India. Nearly 6,000 years before Jesus, the Sumerians were the first to open the doors of astrology to the Western world. The Sumerians laid the foundation for scientific study of the constellation of stars. They constructed a giant tower 700 feet tall, and from that tower Sumerian priests used to observe the sky 24 hours a day. Sumerian metaphysicians soon learned that whatever happens to mankind is somehow ultimately connected with the stars. They are the source. 6,000 years before Jesus, it was the view in Sumeria that whenever illness occurs, whenever epidemics are born, the stars are somehow connected with it. These days, there is a scientific basis for this. And those who understand the science of astrology today say it was Sumerians who began the history of human civilization. In the present day world, it was 1920 when a Russian scientist, Chizhevsky, he investigated this matter deeply and discovered that every 11 years, enormous explosions take place on the sun. Every 11 years, a nuclear explosion occurs on the sun. And Chizhevsky discovered that whenever such nuclear explosions occur on the sun, wars, revolutions begin on Earth. According to him, during the past 700 years, whenever such phenomena have occurred on the sun, there have been disasters on the Earth. But his analysis could not be accepted. It was against the Marxian viewpoint. It was the time when Stalin was in power. So in 1920, Stalin got him arrested and threw him into the prison. And he was kept in Siberia. Only after the death of Stalin that Chizhevsky was released. For Stalin, the conclusions of Chizhevsky must have seemed very strange. And according to Marxist and communist thinking, whatever revolutions occur on the earth, it is fundamentally because of the economic differences between men. But Chizhevsky declared that the cause of revolution is in fact the explosions happening on the sun. How can explosions on the sun possibly be related to the existence of poverty or wealth in the lives of men? If Chizhevsky's thesis is correct, then the entire Marxian understanding disintegrates. It becomes futile. Then you cannot explain revolutions any longer in reference to economic and class struggle. Then only astrology can explain the revolutions. However, Chizhevsky could not be proved wrong. His calculations covering the 700 years were scientific. The connection he established between explosions on the sun and the phenomena on Earth was so close that to prove him wrong was almost impossible. But to send him to Siberia was a simple matter. It was after the death of Stalin, when Khrushchev came into power, he released Chizhevsky from Siberia. It was nearly 50 years he has remained in the captivity, and he lost those 50 years. After his release, he lived only 4 to 6 months, but in those few months, he gathered together even more evidence for his thesis. He also linked the spread of epidemics on the earth to solar influences. The sun is not a static ball of fire, as we ordinarily think. Instead, it is an indefinitely alive and dynamic fiery organism. The sun changes its mood every moment, and when sun changes its mood, even a little, life on earth is affected. And this has been the forerunner for Indian astrology. Nothing happens on the earth without something happening on the sun. According to Bhagavad Gita, in chapter 4, when Arjun was inquiring how this knowledge disseminated on earth, he said, "First I gave it to the sun, the god of sun, and from sun it came to Manu, and from Manu to Ikshvaku, and then it came to all entire humanity." Sun represents consciousness in spirituality, or light, or awareness. First, whatsoever thought or whatsoever illness is, it happens at a plane where you cannot connect to it. You have no way to reach to that plane. It is only the mystics, masters who have been able to see the disease or something happening at that level. Astrology somehow tries to do through calculations. Masters do it through their intuition and kashp. And if we can capture the disease at that level, when it has not yet manifested, the healing can happen much easier. And this is the level where the bodily fluids, it used to be said that disease reaches the body through cells, but it is not accepted now. Every moment cells are undergoing the process of disintegration and new cells are being formed. Blood continues to change, and it is said in 3 to 4 months the entire blood is changing. But there are various fluids, the cerebrospinal fluid, the fluid in liver and other parts. It is there the disease contracts for the first time and then descends. So this is because of the movement of the sun, or explosions taking place at the sun. So sun is not a static ball of fire as we ordinarily think. Instead, it is an infinitely alive and dynamic fiery organism. The sun changes its mood every moment. And when sun changes its mood, even a little, life on earth is affected. Nothing happens on earth without something happening on the sun. When there is a solar eclipse, the birds in the forest stop singing 24 hours before. During the entire time of the eclipse, the whole earth becomes silent. The birds stop their singing, and all the animals of the forest become oppressed and frightened. Full of apprehension, the monkeys abandon their trees and come down below. They form themselves into groups, apparently as a means of protection. And it is a surprising thing that these monkeys, who are always gossiping and making a human cry, become so quiet at the time of eclipse that even the meditators cannot compare with them. Chizhevsky explained this entire matter, but such thinking first originated in Sumeria. Thereafter, there was a Swiss physician named Paracelsus. He was born in late 1493 and died in September 24th, 1541. He discovered more information. He made an unparalleled discovery, and his discovery will transform all of the medical science, if not today, then tomorrow. Up until his discovery could not be considered valid because astrology is such an ignored subject, the most ancient, the most ignored, yet most respected at all times. Sometimes ago in France, it was calculated that 47% of the population believes that astrology is a science. Now in America, there are nearly 5,000 leading astrologers. They are working day and night assiduously. There are so many clients that the work of astrologers can never come to an end. It is estimated that throughout the world, 78% of the people believe in astrology, and 78% who believe in astrology belong to general public. Thinkers and intellectuals are on the red alert at the very mention of astrology. It was Swedish physician Carl Gustav Jung said that the university doors have been closed to astrology for 300 years. But in the coming 30 years, the doors will again open and astrology will enter the precincts of the university. It will happen because claims that astrology has made, which have up to now remained unproved, can now be proved. The Swiss physician Paracelsus gave birth to a new discovery that man become ill only when the harmonious relationship between him and the constellation of stars at the birth somehow breaks down. This was the finding of Pythagoras. At the time the child takes birth, many stars emerge on the earth's horizon and create a harmony. He called it as the harmony of the cosmos. For this, a little explanation is necessary. Many years before Paracelsus, some 6,000 years before Christ BC, Pythagoras gave birth to a new valuable principle of planetary harmony. When Pythagoras proclaimed this principle in Greece, he had just returned from his journey trip to Egypt and India. At that time when he came, India was intensely absorbed in the ideas of Buddha and Mahavir. That was the time. Because Pythagoras is a contemporary of Buddha and Mahavir. That time, the culture of the world was so rich. In the east, there were Mahavir and Buddha. In the west, there was Pythagoras. But Pythagoras is more recognized for his mathematics. In the same way, Umar Khayyam is recognized for his poetry, not his astronomical understanding and mathematics. After his return to Greece, he included in his report a specific reference to Buddhist and Jain monks. He gave Jain monks the name of Janosophists and also reported that they walked about naked. Pythagoras believed that every star, every planet, and every satellite gives out a unique vibration through its movement as it travels in space. Every movement of stars gives out a vibration, and every star has its own individual movement. All the vibrations of stars together make a musical harmony, and he called this harmony of the universe. When you are born, the melody that is created by tuning of the stars at that time is inscribed on your mind and it remains fresh. Most unsophisticated and most sensitive state, that of birth. Throughout your life, this will cause good health or ill health. When you live in tune with the original musical harmony that existed at the time of your birth, then you are healthy. And whenever you are tuning with this fundamental musical harmony breaks down, illness is the result. In this connection, the work of Paracelsus was very important. He did some significant work. He would not prescribe medicine to any patient until he had seen his horoscope, his astrological birth chart. And it is a surprising thing that after having explained a person's birth chart, Paracelsus could cure the patient who had confused other physicians. Patients could not be cured by other physicians. He used to say, until I know the position of stars at the time of the birth of this man, and it is not possible to know his inner harmony, it is impossible to correct it. And unless I know the arrangement of his inner harmony, how can I make this person healthy? What is meant by health? We are trying to understand this word health. Ordinarily, if we ask a physician what is the definition of health, he will only say health is the absence of sickness. But this is a negative definition. It is unfortunate that we must define health in terms of illness. Health is a positive phenomenon, a positive state, and illness is negative. Health is your nature. Illness is an attack on your nature. So it is very strange that we must define health in terms of illness. To define the host in terms of the guest is very strange. Health coexists with you. Illness comes occasionally like a guest. Health accompanies us at the birth. Illness is a superficial phenomenon. But if we ask a physician to define health, we can only say health is present when illness is not there. Paracelsus used to say that this interpretation is wrong. The concept of health needs to be positively defined. But how can we reach a positive definition and interpretation of the concept of health that will be created? He used to say, until the state of your inner harmony is known, you can at best only be released from your illness. Because your inner harmony is the source of your health. But when you are relieved from one illness, you will immediately get another. Because nothing has been done about your inner harmony. Your inner harmony has to be supported. 500 years have passed since Paracelsus, and his discoveries have discovered into oblivion. But now, during the past 20 years, astrology has re-emerged. During this time, a new science has been born. It was 1950. A new science was born, and this was called as cosmic chemistry. The originator of this science was Yogi Gardi, one of the most significant men of this century. After endless experiments in the laboratory, this man proved scientifically that the whole universe is an organic unity. But this has always been the view of the spiritual masters. He proved scientifically that whole universe is an organic unity, that the whole universe is one body. If my finger is hurt, then my whole body is affected. And that is how it happens. The body means that no limb is separate. All are joined together. If my eye is in pain, then my big toe also experiences that pain. If my foot is hurt, the message reaches the heart. If my mind is ill, my entire body will be disturbed. If my whole body is destroyed, then it will affect my mind to find anywhere to be. The body is an organic unity. Touch a single part and the whole body vibrates. All the parts are affected. This can easily be seen, experienced in a love relation. You touch the person at a certain place, the vibration reaches the like an electric current throughout the body. Cosmic chemistry says that entire cosmos is a body. Nothing in it stands alone. All things are joined together. So no matter how distant a star may be from us, when it changes, our heartbeat also changes. And no matter how far the sun may be, when it becomes very disturbed, our blood circulation is also disturbed. Every 11 years an atomic storm occurs on the sun, and the last time such an atomic storm, the fiery explosions were going on, a Japanese doctor called Dr. Tameta made an amazing discovery. His research is very important in this field, a scientific study of astrology. He made an important discovery. He was a medical professional. He had been working on women's body for 20 years. There is one property unique to female blood, which is absent in the blood of males. At the time of menstruation, the blood of the woman becomes thin, but man's blood always remains the same. Women's blood at the time of menstruation grows thin. At the time of pregnancy, also their blood grows thin. According to Dr. Tameto, this is one of the basic differences between the blood of men and women. And when atomic energy storms are occurring on the sun with great intensity, the blood of the men also grew thin. And this was a very noble phenomenon. Before, it had never been recorded that man's blood was affected by the disturbance on the sun. And if blood can be so affected, then anything can be affected. As an American thinker, there was a person, Frank Brown, who had been working on the safety and the facility aspects of space travelers. For half of his life, he has made it his task to ensure that men who travel into space will face no difficulty. The most serious problem is how they will be affected as they leave the Earth's atmosphere. So no one knows how much atomic radiation they may encounter or how it will affect them. But 2000 years after Aristotle, in the West it was thought that the space is empty and nothing is there. 2000 miles away from the Earth's atmosphere, it was said that the atmosphere ceases to exist and there is empty space. But investigation of space travelers have proved this to be wrong. Space is not empty, it is very full. It is neither empty nor dead. it is extremely alive and still. The truth is that 2000 miles wide layer surrounds the Earth's atmosphere, and it prevents many harmful influences from reaching us. But in space, all kind of strange currents are flowing, the effect of which man will not be able to withstand. You will be surprised to learn this. You will laugh. But before he would let a man be sent into space, Frank Brown sent a potato in space. It was Brown's contention that there is a very little essential difference between a man and a potato. If the potato rots, then man cannot survive. If potato survives, then man may also survive. Potato is a very hardy organism, and man is very sensitive. If even a potato cannot survive in space, then there is no hope for the survival of man in this space. If a potato returns alive, and if it sprouts after being sown in the ground, then man can be sent into space. This was his research, Frank Brown. However, there would still be concern about man's ability to survive. From his experiment, Brown proved one more important thing, that a potato seed lying in the ground, or any seed lying in the ground, grows only in relation to sun. The sun alone arouses it and encourages it to emerge. Sun alone summons the embryo plant and induces its growth. Brown also did research in another field, and other subjects have even now not been given a suitable name, but at the present it is called planetary heredity. There is another word in English, horoscope, which comes from the Greek word horoscopes. The meaning of the word horoscope is, I observe the emerging planets. Horoscope simply means I observe emerging planets. As at the moment child is born, many stars are emerging around the Earth's horizon. Just as sun rises in the morning and sets in the evening, so stars rise and set in space 24 hours a day. If a child is being born at 6 o'clock in the morning, at that time sun 2 is rising. At that time some stars are also rising and others are setting. There is a constellation. Some constellation are on the decline, the others are ascent. Child is being born into a certain arrangement of stars in this space. Up to now we have doubted, but even now many people not deeply familiar with the subject still doubt that the moon and the stars can have anything to do with the man. Wherever the stars may be, what difference will it make to some child being born in a village? And then, too, on the same day, under the same constellation, not just one child, but thousands of children are born. Among them, one may become the president of a country, but the remainder will not. Among these, one may live for 100 years, another after 2 days. Among them may be one a genius and the other an idiot. So from a superficial viewpoint, one might ask how a child can be related to a horoscope just by being born under a certain constellation and planetary pattern. The logic of such questions seems clear and direct, and Why would the stars be connected with the birth of a single child? And then too, not just one child is born. Under the very same stars, many are born who are not all alive. From such logic, it seems that birth of a human being has no connection with the stars. But the investigations of Brown, Picardi, Tomato and others, we can draw a great conclusion. All these scientists say, while we cannot claim that a child as an individual is influenced by the stars, still we can say to a certain extent that life as a whole is affected. Whether a child is influenced as an individual, we cannot now say or know. But life as a whole is. And if life as a whole is, then as we investigate the facts of the matter more deeply, we will discover that the individual too is affected by the stars and their movements. One thing more must be considered. It has been thought that astrology is a science which, because it originated in earlier times, could not develop. But I am of the view that the situation is now changed. Astrology was an infinitely developed science in some extremely advanced civilizations. But those civilizations have been lost, and only incomplete fragments of this astrology have remained in our hands. This gives a tremendous importance on oral traditions. In almost all the mystic traditions, there is an importance on oral traditions. I am speaking. These words can be written also. But when you are reading the written words, you do not understand the intonation, the voice modulation, the gaps between the words. It is not the written word that creates a harmony. It is the spoken words that creates a musical symphony or harmony. When you look at me while I am speaking, the gestures, the movements, the gaps, the intonation. When Holy Prophet spoke to Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq Raziyallahu Ta'ala, no, we have the written words. But what was his gesture? What was his expression? What was the gap? With what intensity he spoke a word? How he modulated it? We are not know. We do not know. And unless we know that, we will not understand the real meaning. We see the, read the written words of Bhagavad Gita. How did Krishna spoke to Arjuna? When he became silent, when he looked at Arjuna with awe, when it is only when you realize that, you reach to that state, then you will be able to figure out and grasp that matter. In the second chapter of Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna has completed the first chapter where he spoke non-stop, and that is known as Arjuna's Vishad Yoga, the grief he talks about, the confusion he talks about. The mind is in a state of confusion. Now, Krishna says in the seventh verse of chapter 2nd, and that's the first sutra that he spoke, Kutashtva Kashmal Midam Vishme Samupasthitam. He would have looked at him, asked him, from where did all this crap has come into your mind? And then he would become silent, as if he is giving an opportunity to Arjuna to introspect within. From where did all this crap has come into your mind? Sometimes when you observe how did the master spoke to you, when you mention all these talks which you consider as talks of wisdom, your asinine wisdom, Master looks at you. He said, is it so? This is a gesture. The word, we cannot say, is it so? But his gesture, his bent of the head, looking deep into your eyes, says the unheard. How can you read this through the written words? This was the importance of the oral tradition, which is lost. And unless we go into that, and it is because of this, many things have been lost. Astrology is not a new science which needs to be developed. It is a science which was at a time very advanced. But only certain fragments, the civilizations which were well versed into it, then those are lost. We have only fragments. We can only understand the message of Holy Prophet through the oral tradition of the Masters, or the message of Bhagavad Gita through oral traditions. Then the civilization which developed astrology or the other sciences was lost. Civilizations came and go every day. The fundamentals, the basic sayings and the basic principles of those things which have been developed by them got lost. Today science is approaching the point where it will accept the thesis that life as a whole is affected by the movement of the star. At the time of the birth, the condition of child's mind is exactly like a very sensitive photoplate. Two or three things need to be thought about if we want to understand how life is affected. And only if life is affected, can there be a possibility of astrology, not otherwise. We should try to understand the phenomena of twins. Very important phenomenon. The type of twins exist. One is identical twin, those who are born from one egg, and other type is that of those who, although they are twins, but are born from separate eggs. In mother's womb, two eggs become fertilized, two children are born as twins. The first type is more rare, two children born from one egg. They are very significant subjects to study because they are born at the same time. Out of necessity, we call the children born from separate eggs as twins. But the moment of their birth is not exactly the same. It must be understood that birth is an ambiguous phenomenon. First aspect of birth is conception. Actual birth takes place on the day when fetus is conceived in mother's womb. This is actual birth. What we call birth is really birth number two, when child comes out of mother's womb. As we were to carry out a complete astrological investigation, as the Hindus alone have done, and done very thoroughly, then our actual concern would not begin when the child is born. Our actual concern begins when the child starts his journey in mother's womb, when the conception takes place, because that is the actual birth. So Hindus have also come to feel that if a particular type of child is to be born, it will be born if the intercourse and pregnancy occur under an arrangement of planets and constellation most suitable for that time. Now I will explain to you a little of the background of this, because much work has been done in this area and many things have become clear. Ordinarily, when a child is born at 6 o'clock in the morning, we thought that the constellation which existed at that time influences the child. But those who know astrology deeply say that the stars do not cast their influence over the child, thus because just because it is born at 6 o'clock in the morning. No, rather the child chooses to be born under those stars which will influence him as he wishes to be influenced. This is a radically different thing. When a child is taking birth, it chooses, it has a capacity to choose the planets and stars and the movements at which it will take birth. And if we go still more deeper, then the child also chooses the time of its conception. Every soul chooses its own time of conception, when it will accept the womb and at which moment. The moment of conception is not insignificant. It is significant in that it is a question of how the entire universe exists at that moment, and to what sort of possibility the universe opens the door at that moment. All these are relevant. When two children are conceived together from one egg, then the moment of their conception is seen, and the moment of their birth will also be seen. It is interesting that the lives of two children who have taken birth from one egg are so alike that it is difficult to say that the moment of birth has no influence. The IQ of twins born from one egg is just about equal. And those who know say that the fractional difference which arises is because of our faulty measuring devices. Even today, we have not been able to develop adequate criteria by which we can quantitatively measure the intelligence of the person. If twins born from the same egg are brought up far apart from each other, their intelligence quotient will not differ. Even if one child is raised in India and the other in China, and neither is aware of the existence of the other, this will still be true. Cases have occurred where such twins have been raised far apart from each other until they have attained maturity and their levels of IQ did not differ. It is surprising that IQ can be associated with the child's potential at the birth. When the twin who lives in China suffers from a cold, at the same time is the other twin in India also suffers from cold. Generally, twins born from one egg die in the same year, at the most 3 years lapse between the death, and at least 3 days, between 3 days to 3 years. If a twin has died, then we can assume that after 3 days or 3 years, the other will also die. Their attitudes, their behaviors, their feelings are parallel. And it seems that two live in almost exactly the same way. Their similarity is seen in many other things as well. Each acts like the carbon copy of the other. Everyone's skin is individual. If my hand is damaged and new skin needs to be grafted, then your skin cannot be grafted into my hand. It would be necessary to use the piece of my own skin. On the entire earth, there will be no one whose skin can be grafted into my hand. My body will give signs of rejection. It will not accept another skin. However, the skin of twins born out of one egg can be transplanted. This is the only exception If the skin of one is grafted into the skin of the other, there will be no rejection. Why is that? What is the cause? Why? We cannot say that it is because they are from the same parents. Because even though two brothers may have the same parents, their skin cannot be interchanged. The only exception found in those children who were conceived at the same moment, even between them, no other common factor exists. They are brothers who came from the same parents, but their skin cannot be interchanged. The skin of one brother cannot be grafted into the other. The only moment of the difference was that the moment of their births differ. The mother and father are the same. Everything else is the same. The only difference, they differ greatly in only in one thing, and that is the moment of their conception. That's why you will find that there is a tremendous difference between the two children, two brothers. Is the moment of birth so influential that life span is of the same length, that their IQ is almost equal, that their bodies, their bodily behavior is the same, that when two fall ill, it is from the same illness, and that when two become well again, it is from the same medicine? Can the moment of birth be so influential? Astrology has been saying that the moment of birth is even more important than this. But up to now, science have not agreed with astrology. But it is now beginning to do so. In coming to this increasing agreement, some new experiments have been helpful. For example, when we launched man-made satellites into space, we discovered that a wide range of radioactive rays from the space and the constellations are continuously bombarding the Earth. Nothing on the Earth is unaffected of this phenomenon. And now the ocean is influenced by moon. But we have not taken into consideration the fact that the same proportion of water and salt that occurs in the ocean also occurs in human body. The same proportion. 70% of human body consists of water, and the proportion of salt contained in that water is same as that contained in the Arabian Sea. The water in the ocean is affected by moon. And how could the water inside the body remain unaffected by the movement of the moon? Now, in this connection, two or three facts emerging from the recent investigations you must remember. For example, as the day of full moon approaches, the amount of insanity in the world increases. Whereas on the last day of the darker fortnight, the least number of people go insane. As the moon grows brighter, the level of insanity also increases. On the day of the full moon, the greatest number of people enter madhouse. And on the last day of the moon's waning period, the greater number of people are discharged from the madhouse. Its statistics is now available. In English, we use the word lunatic. In Hindi, we use the word chand mara. Chand refers to moon, just as lunar in English language refers. Chand mara is a very ancient term, and the word lunar is also almost 3000 years old. Some 3000 years ago, people realized that moon affects the insanity. And if it affects the insane, then how can it avoid affecting the sane? In the final analysis, the construction of the brain and the internal composition of the body are the same for all. Yes, it may be that moon affects the insane to a greater extent and the sane to a lesser extent, but this is simply a quantitative difference. It is impossible that the sane remain completely unaffected by moon. If that was true, then nobody would go mad, because everybody who goes mad was once sane. Moon must have first effect on those who are sane. In this field, there is an important study made by Professor Brown. He was a man completely without any faith in astrology. He was a skeptic. And his earlier writings, he had been very much against astrology, and in fact, he ridiculed. Yet despite his skepticism, he began some investigation. He gathered together the birth charts of many famous generals, doctors, and other professionals. But then he found himself in great difficulty, because he discovered that the number of particular professions were born under a specific planet, under the same constellation. For instance, among all the famous generals, the influence of Mars upon their lives was stronger, whereas the lives of academicians, the influence of Mars was completely absent. The study which Brown carried out on some 50,000 men who were army officers revealed that the influence of Mars is very strong in the lives of these men. Generally, when such personalities take birth, the planet Mars is in ascending position. The moment of their birth is the moment when Mars begins to rise, exactly opposite to this. No matter how many pacifists were studied, they were never born at the time when the planet Mars was ascending. If it happened only occasionally, you could think it was a coincidence, but there cannot be a thousand of cases of coincidence. Mathematicians are born under a different and a specific constellation. Poets are never born under the same constellation. It is an occasional case. There may be a coincidence. When it happens so often, it cannot be considered a mere coincidence. Mathematicians are born under a specific constellation. Poets are never born under that same constellation. In an occasional case, there may be a coincidence, but when it happens so often, it cannot be considered a coincidence. In fact, there is a great difference in behavior among people of different professions and occupations. For example, between poets, mathematicians, and war generals and pacifists. On one hand, there may be a man like Bertrand Russell who says that there should be peace in the world, but on the other hand, men like Nietzsche who say that the day war ceases, the world will cease to be meaningful. It is only an intellectual dispute between them, and also a dispute of the stars. Is there only an intellectual dispute between them, or does the moment of their birth also separate them? More research is done, and more is being realized that a specific talent of a person is revealed by the time of his birth. Those who know about astrology, even superficially, would say that this happens because he is born under a specific constellation. But I want to say that a man chooses the constellation under which he is to be born. He will be born under the appropriate constellation according to what he wants to be. And this is the case with the awakened ones. Whatever his innate possibilities, whatever the shape of his last life taken, in this in its entirety, whatever his motivating consciousness, every child, every new life insists on a specific moment of birth. It wants to be born at a specific moment. It wants to be conceived as a specific moment. Both are interdependent. In the Hindu scripture Ramayana, Tulsidas has explained at the time of birth of Ram. He gives the first situation, what is the nature, what is the time, Madhya Divas, middle of the day, Atishit Naghama, neither too cold nor too hot. The cold breeze, pleasant breeze is blowing. Madhya Divas Atishit Naghama, Pavan Kal Loka Vishrama. He describes all that and he comes to the birth at that time. Now is the time of the birth. As I have told you, the water of the ocean is the subject to certain influences. But all life is created out of water. Without water, no life is possible. In ancient Greece, philosophers used to say that only from water is life born. That water is life. Ancient Indian, Chinese and other mythologies also confirm that. And today, scientists who believe in the process of evolution also say that life is born out of water. That perhaps the first life on the planet lived in the water as algae. It was the first form of life, and then out of this, man eventually evolved. Water is the most mysterious element of all. Whatever influence reach man from the stars or from the universe, from outer space, reach him through the medium of water. That's why when I mentioned about carbon, those organic elements, they were relevant. Water is a derivative of carbon, and it is the water comes from hydrogen and oxygen. Only after affecting the water in man's body can any radiation gain access to him. Much work is being done with water, and many mysteries concerning water are coming to our attention. In Japan, I think it is Dr. Tameta who is working on the water. The biggest mystery about the water that has come to attention of the scientists is almost 10 years ago, is that water possesses a lot of sensitivity. Whatever influences are active from whatever direction in life, they first move through a medium of water. Water in us is the first thing to be affected. That is why the bodily fluids are to be affected. First, when a disease contracts, it is through the bodily fluids. And if we can somehow connect to that, we can create a healing in an individual. The water in which a child floats in the mother's womb possesses the same proportion of salt as is present in the ocean. Influences from the mother's body do not reach the child directly. There is no direct connection between the mother and the child growing in the womb. The medium is water. Whatever influence reaches the child from the mother, it is through the medium of water. There is no other direct relationship between them. Then throughout our lives, water in our bodies behave just like the water in the ocean. Fish in the ocean has been much studied. There are fish that come onto the seashore and lay their eggs at low tides when the ocean is receding. Riding with the waves, the fish comes onto the sand, lays their egg, and returns to the ocean at a fixed time, the tides return, and by then the eggs have been hatched and the span will have come out. Then the incoming tide will take that back into the ocean. This happens with turtles. Scientists who have studied these fish were surprised because the fish always comes to lay their eggs at low tide. Scientists were very puzzled as to how these fish know when it is going to be low tide. If there were even the slightest mistake in timing, the egg would have been washed away. But in hundreds of thousands of years, they have never made a mistake. If they have made a mistake, they would have disappeared as a species. But they have never made a single mistake. What equipments do fish possess by which they can know about the tides? What sense organ do they possess that tell them when the tide will ebb? 100,000 of fish will gather together at the same time over the entire seashore. These fish must possess some kind of signaling system, some kind of transmitter. 100,000 of fish will come from thousands of miles away to lay their eggs on ocean beach, and all at the same time. When a tsunami or a storm is to occur, the birds stop singing and disappear. Those who have studied the phenomena see there can be no source of information other than moon. Moon is the source of the fish intuition, nothing else. The fish knows intuitively when tide is ebbing and when it is rising. The impact of moon is the only way that they come to know about the tides. There was another possibility. It has been conjured by these fish might somehow be influenced by the waves of the ocean. So scientists put them in place where there are no ocean waves, in water, in an unlit room. But the result turned out to be really surprising. The fish were enveloping in darkness. The moon was not in the view. There was no light visible at all. But when moon reached the exact point at which the fish in the ocean would go and lay their eggs on the shore, at exactly the same moment, the fish in the laboratory laid their egg. What does this show? That it is not a question of the waves of the ocean. Someone may suggest that a race begins when fish receive signals from each other, but this hypothesis does not hold water, does not stand. Scientists have witnessed the fish when they were isolated from each other. They have tried to disturb the brain of those fish in every way. They have placed the fish in darkness for 24 hours. So the fish do not know when it is morning and when it is night. They have observed these fish after placing them under a bright light for 24 hours so that the fish would not know when it is day. They have observed them after setting up the artificial moon and daily either decreasing or increasing its brightness, but these fish could not be fooled. When the real moon comes to the right point, only at that moment the fish laid their eggs. Wherever they were, they would lay their eggs at that moment. Every year, thousands of birds fly thousands of miles Winter is on its way, and soon it will be fall. Birds begin to migrate from the areas where snow will fall. They will fly to places thousands of miles away to reach this winter home. So these birds migrate exactly 1 month before the approaching of the snow. And at the time they are migrating, the snow has not yet begun to fall, but exactly a month later it will fall. How do these birds calculate the date on which snow will fall? Our weathermen, who have the most elaborate observatories, cannot come up with the exact information. I have heard that some weathermen say, first ask astrologers sitting on the roadside, what do you think? Will it rain or not? The arrangements which man has made seems childish. Birds know a month and a half, even 2 months before the first fall of snow. After thousands of experiments, it has been observed that the day on which the birds migrate is fixed for every type of bird. But every year the date changes, because there is no fixed date for snow to fall. But it is certain that every bird will migrate 1 month before the snow falls. If the snow is to fall 10 days later, then in the previous year they will migrate 10 days later than they did in that year. If the snow falls 10 days earlier, they will migrate 10 days earlier. In Japan, there is a particular bird which will evacuate a town 24 hours before an earthquake occurs. It was said when the tsunami occurred in the southern part of India and the Southeast Asia, the birds have migrated, but we do not understand these symbols that are happening. It is just an ordinary bird. There are many of them in every town, but 24 hours before an earthquake, these birds will evacuate the town. At present, the scientists are unable to accurately predict whether an earthquake is coming. Earthquake is coming even 2 hours beforehand. 2 hours before, they are still uncertain. They are still unsure. There is only a probability that an earthquake may happen. But in Japan, people know 24 hours in advance that earthquake is coming. When this bird flies away, the people of the town know now there is only 24 hours time. The bird has left. Not a single one of the species remain in town. How these birds come to know? For some 10 years now, scientists have been saying something new, that every living organism possesses an internal sensor which feels the cosmic influence. Perhaps man too possesses it, but has lost awareness of it through depending on his intellect. That's why the entire message of the masters is to move from intelligence to awareness. Man is the only living being in the world who has, through his own intelligence, lost many things which once he had. Through the same intelligence, he has obtained many things he never had before, but outcome is that he has ended up in the danger of self-destruction. What he had, he has lost. And what he did not have, he has invented. But even the tiniest living organism possesses an inner intuitive soul. In Sufism, we call this as Kashf. Now, scientific data is becoming available about this. I was talking about Paracelsus. Present-day physicians are also coming to the conclusion that whenever the sun spots emerge and grow on the sun, illness on the earth increases, and that whenever the sunspots decrease, illness on the earth also decreases. As long as sunspots continue to happen, we will never get rid of disease on earth. Even 11 years. Every 11 years, there is a great turmoil on the sun and huge explosions take place. Whenever an explosion or turmoil occurs on the sun, wars and disturbance occur on earth. The wars that take place on earth follow a 10-year cycle. Epidemics also follow a 10 or 11 year cycle. Revolutions also follow an approximately 10 or 11 year cycles. Once you are aware of this, that we are not separate or isolated but joined, bound by each other by a cosmic force in an organic way, then it will be easy to understand astrology. It is for this reason that I have been explaining this to you. In the past, some people have thought and even now think that astrology is a superstition, a blind faith. To a great extent, it seems to be true. Those things for which it is difficult to find scientific explanation seems to us based only on blind faith. But astrology is scientific. The meaning of science is investigation of the relationship between cause and effect. Astrology says that when whatever happens on this earth is not uncaused, however we may not be aware of the causes, astrology says that the space which the future will take cannot be isolated from the past, but must be connected to it. What you become tomorrow will be connected to what you are today. What you were until today is connected to you tomorrow.